Sensex and Nifty bounce in and out of the green following big swings in global equities overnight as some fear around selling by the hedge funds abate. Now the auto as well as real estate stocks gain mid-caps outperform.
Shares of Shriram Transport Finance and TVS Motor gain on good results. On the losing side, Mahindra Finance slides after a disappointing show, while Lupin slips on concerns over one-offs and uncertainty over the outcome of US FDA inspections.
Setback for Tata Steel as talks between Tata Steel and Saab for the purchase of Imudin Steel Mills collapses. As per Saab CEO, the transaction would not align with their sustainability strategy and meet financial expectations.
And CNBC TV 18 learns that the OFS for Tata Communications is likely in February, indicating a clear intent of the government to speed up divestments. The stock of BPCL2 rises.
Hello and welcome. You've tuned us on Business Lunch, and those were the top headlines. But what we are watching out for ahead of the budget is the economic survey, and some bits of information from there has already been released. In fact, let's take it straight across to Lata Venkatesh, who's joining us with all the details. Lata.
Okay, well, all the details is all of about two numbers. We have this, which our colleague Sapna Das has picked up, that the GDP is likely to contract by 7.7%. This information is about 1 month old. I think it was on Jan 7th that it was released by the CSO. And expectedly, the government will go with that number for the current year. On that basis, they will work out the GDP for the next year, which also Sapna has got for us. I think they will go with an 11.5% real GDP growth for FY22, which is exactly what the IMF told us. Now, this is a little better. There were many people, at least our poll, threw up a number of 11%. So 11.5% is the growth estimate.
Now revise that number to 11.
Okay, so it's come back to 11. That was what our poll said, that it will be 11%. And on that, you normally have an inflation deflator that you add. So that, assuming the inflation will be 4%, which is the mandate of the MPC, you will work with a nominal GDP number of 15%, which is exactly what our poll also threw up. This is on expected lines. So now that clarifies, the clears the air on what will be the basis. Okay, no, Sumaira, I think they are going with 11.5, or
11
they're looking at
15.4 is nominal.
So they must be assuming a slightly higher deflator. So 15.4% is the GDP number they're going with, slightly higher than what many people have told us, but still lower than a couple of estimates. Nomura is going with a 17% GDP growth, and Credit Suisse also estimates that next year's nominal GDP growth may be 17%, but they were all expecting the government to go with only 15%. So this 15.4% is important. I don't think the street will be very unhappy or believe that, oh, the government is going with unrealistic numbers. There's not so much to choose between 15 and 15.4 nominal GDP growth. And therefore, I think the market borrowing number could be a little, on the higher side. If you have 5.2% or 5% of a 15.4% GDP and a 15% GDP, there is a difference. You know, if you're looking at a bigger numerator of 15.4% GDP growth, then maybe there will be a slightly higher borrowing number. But let's wait and see. I mean, we are running away with our imagination. 15.4 is a smidge higher than what we were working with, which was a 15% GDP growth. I think economy likely to recover full momentum over the next few years. That may be the economic survey's tone. Okay, so that's what they're going with. Well, that's what we have, and we will get some economists to comment on this number. Maybe you want to carry on with other news, Sumaira, and our team will be calling up economists.
Yeah, just a quick check on the market also, because now we're at the low point. We broke 13,800 on the Nifty just a few minutes ago, about 5 minutes ago, and the market continues to slide further. So now down about a quarter odd percent on the Nifty. What's not doing well is clearly clutch of banks, though the bank Nifty continues to hold out in the green for now. But look at SBI, IndusInd, Axis Bank, all of these are stocks which are headed lower. But Lata, I believe we're now joined by Mr. Soumyakanti Ghosh,
yes,
of SBI.
Yes, the Chief Economic Advisor of State Bank of India is with us. Soumya, this is what our reporter has picked up, that the FY22 real GDP is expected to grow at 11%. That is likely to be the assumption of the budget itself, and 15.4% nominal GDP growth. What are your comments?
We are also with 11% real GDP projections for FY22 and a nominal GDP number of 15%. But given the way the economy has recovered and given the way the fiscal numbers are looking right now in terms of tax collections, in terms of GST revenue numbers, which is due very soon, and also the numbers of CSO data for FY18, 19, 20 are due today in the evening. Mm. So if we go by all this, I think 15% could be a reasonable assumption, but the budget may actually go with a higher nominal GDP if the trends current now are any indication, because that will give them more leeway of spending next year.
But are they assuming a higher inflation then? Why would you go with the 11% nominal real GDP and a 15.4% nominal GDP? The other way would have perhaps been more legit, you know, that you go with the 11.4% real GDP and nominal GDP of 15. Are they assuming higher inflation then? I mean,
I think they will go with a higher real GDP rather than a real inflation, because that will actually give a wrong signal to the market. So I think they will go with a higher real GDP and possibly a deflator, okay, which could be around 3.5 to 4%. So that will make up around 15 to 16%, but maybe a tad higher than 15%. What is the benchmark which most of the market believes as of now for next year's budget?
Okay. So 15.4% will not be taken negatively that they are over-assuming, right? It's okay. It's par for the course?
Yes, because the issue is that, Lata, I think the 7.7% number is likely to be revised downwards, because the third quarter GDP number and the fourth quarter GDP number, which the CSO has built into the 7.7%, are actually negative numbers. So as of now, I think if you look into the leading indicators and the model actually shows that there could be a positive element in the Q3 GDP number also. So if we take all these factors into account with a possible upward revision in the FY21 GDP numbers, that actually will build a base for a higher nominal GDP in the FY22 budget. And the important thing is that this nominal GDP will be actually, I can say that it's a clean nominal GDP, because this will be dominated for whatever reasons by higher real GDP number and possibly an inflation number, which will not be that high in terms of the historical experiences which we have seen.
1 minute, Soumya. We've also got Anant Narayan joining us, Professor of Finance at SP Jain Institute, and of course, a former bond market dealer. Anant, these are the numbers that we have got, an 11% real GDP growth next year based on a minus 7.7 for the current year, and a possible assumption of nominal GDP growth of 15.4. Do they tally with your expectation?
It's definitely possible, Lata. Look, it's going to be a conjecture at this point, but the signs are available that there could be a robust rebound in consumption. Hmm. And there's also expectation that government spending will continue to remain healthy. While investment might kind of lag, purely on the basis of consumption and government spending growth, there is reason to expect that nominal GDP will grow. Now, I think the risks are, twofold, multifold, but the two main ones, Lata, are the following. One is, while consumption and government spending should accrue, will domestic production and job creation keep pace? And that's been our bane in the past as well. Mm. You see consumption going robust, either it feeds inflation because of too much of money chasing too few goods, or it feeds imports. Mm. And, the non-oil imports that we saw in December, hopefully an aberration, was a pretty high number.
Yeah.
So that's going to be one set of risks that we have to worry about. The second set is, while this is a rebound that seems to be visible right now, there is also pain in the system, right? Okay. Whether it is MSMEs.
Anant. Therefore, are you saying that if they assume a 15.4% nominal GDP, it gives them more elbow room for expenditure, which is good? Is that what you're saying?
I think they do. It does show that they intend to spend. You cannot achieve 15% plus nominal growth unless you see a rebound in consumption and a reasonable amount of government spending. Mm. Given that nobody expects investment to pick up at this point in time, Lata.
Should we therefore derive anything in terms of market borrowing? The poll I did gave me a market borrowing range of 7.5 to 8.3. So let us assume we can go with 7.9 net borrowing, 7.9 lakh crore net borrowing, and gross borrowing of about 10.5 to 11 lakh crore. That's the range I got. But my nominal GDP poll was 15%. Do you think that when they assume 15.4, they will assume a higher borrowing?
I don't think so, Lata. They have ample room to manage. And see, there are multiple things involved here. What you're looking at is the gross dated securities issuance. There's also an overhang of T-bills that they've issued in excess this year, which they'll carry forward as possibly cash the next year. Mm. Plus, we don't know what the PSBR will look like, the public sector borrowing requirements, yes, or the state borrowing. So these are imponderables. Long story short, they can well maintain a 10 to 11 trillion gross borrowing number, as your poll suggested, with these numbers as well.
Okay. Yeah, fair point. Actually, you know, they're also carrying on a lot of cash. The number that was revealed recently, 3.3 lakh crore, isn't it, Soumyo? So that's a lot of cash to draw down, a little more than they normally carry. Normally, the carry forward is, I guess, closer to 2 lakh crore in the month of March. This time, there is more cash probably because the tax inflows have come in late with a delay. 1 minute, gentlemen, Soumyo and Anand, we also got DK Joshi joining us. Mr. Joshi, this is the numbers we have at the moment. The 7.7% minus 7.7 assumption for current year, as the CSO suggested, and 11% real GDP for next year, and a 15.4% nominal GDP assumption for next year. Are you kosher with all these numbers?
Yeah, I think this is broadly in line with what IMF predicted a few days back. And also, I think our own projection was a 10% real GDP growth. And with some upside if government spending is generous, and also if COVID remains under control. I think we will revise our numbers later, but I think broadly, I think the range seems to be somewhere from 10 to 13-14%, I think, for real GDP by various players. And I think we are a little conservative on growth at the moment.
Okay.
But it does, it does.
What is your nominal number? If your real GDP is 10, you will be comfortable with what kind of a nominal GDP?
14 and a half,
Okay, yeah, there were other four. I think ICICI Securities went with a 14 and a half. One or two numbers were 14 and a half. But what is your assumption, therefore, on expenditure? Will there be a slightly more generous expenditure figure? The average, again, that I got from my poll was that it should grow by 10% over current year and therefore be about 30 to 32 lakh crore. You think that by assuming a more generous nominal GDP of 15.4, we should be prepared for a slightly higher expenditure?
Absolutely. I think I would expect the expenditure growth somewhere around 15%, because if the growth does materialize as is expected, I think it implies much better revenue position and the ability to spend while aiming for a somewhat lower fiscal deficit than this year. So I think clearly I think growth is the key here.
Okay. Well, just final thoughts from all three of you, since we have not got any more data. We were hoping that the meat of the survey will be known by now. But anything you would watch out for? Soumyo, you go first.
No, I think, Lata, the only good news is that the numbers are now looking much better if you look into the leading indicators. So we may actually get some recovery in the markets, and the numbers will continue to surprise on the upside in the next 1 or 2 months. And I agree with the fact that the borrowing numbers could actually be a little lower than anticipated, because there is also a lot of cash balances which the government will be carrying. Mm. So that actually will give them added ammunition to finance a part of the fiscal deficit next year and not exclusively borrow on the dated securities.
Okay. Anand, the other one line that we got is that the survey would be woven around the theme near-term pain, long-term gain. We don't know how to interpret it, whether it means that there could be a tax or whether it means that the economy has gone through a pain, which is what the survey is supposed to do. It is supposed to survey the year gone by. But what do you make of this theme? and any carry forward to tomorrow?
So I certainly hope the latter part of what you said is right, Lata. Okay. I think any additional taxes, either income taxes or import tariffs, etc., would be a bad idea at this particular point in time. Yes, there are people who can afford to pay, but the overall economy needs spending to come through. Mm. So I do hope earnestly that it's more about what we've gone through in COVID rather than any additional taxes. But very quickly, Lata, look, the numbers you mentioned, 11%, 15.4%, are well within the realm of possibilities. We have to admit that we are all conjecturing out here because yes. This is out of syllabus. We don't know how things pan out. My own fear is that, or my own risk as I see it, is that while consumption and government spending will hold up, there is a risk of inflation eventually. There is a risk of imports going up and domestic output and job creation not kind of following suit. This is what we went through in 2008, 2013. Which is why I looked through the budget on first. Hopefully, it will give a fillip to domestic production and job creation over time.
Okay.
That should absolutely make 11% and 15% within the realm of possibilities.
Okay. Well, gentlemen, two important bits of news while you all were speaking. The less important news is that Nirmala Sitharaman has tabled the economic survey in the Lok Sabha. But the more important news is normalcy of local trains in Mumbai. I can't tell you how delighted I am. The city has been put through too much. And, the fact that everyone can use local trains normally is a very big positive for the economy. I think the city feeds the Indian economy, and that the fact that people can travel normally from Feb 1st is going to be huge. You know, you can give any number of street vendor loans. The biggest, help that you can give street vendors in the city of Mumbai is to let them travel freely, and you will see the city bustling back to life. I guess you had to take precautions because of COVID, but you may put breaking news as much as you want about Nirmala Sitharaman tabling the economic survey. For me, the biggest headline of the day is starting February 1st, local trains are normalized. Very quickly, all three of you, if you can give me your guesses on what is your fiscal deficit number and what is your net borrowing number. Soumyo, you go first.
We are going with a net borrowing number of the center is around 8 to 8.5 lakh crores, but there could be a downside to it, okay, because just as I mentioned.
Okay.
And in terms of the fiscal deficit number, we are looking at a number next year at 5.3%.
Okay. Mr. Joshi?
Yeah, I think somewhere in the range of 5 to 5.5%. And I think the borrowings definitely below 10.
Okay. That is gross or net?
I think that's a fair question. I think I would say that the gross borrowings will be about 2 trillion less than last year.
Okay.
I think, let me put it this way.
Okay, fine. We are hoping, of course, it will be much less than maybe 3 trillion less. Anand, what would you be comfortable with?
Fiscal deficit 5.5%, gross borrowing about 10.5 trillion rupees.
Okay.
But the headline is not important, Lata. The credibility of the numbers and what goes into the spending mix, etc., is what is important.
All right. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us with your quick take. The survey has just been tabled. So now perhaps we will be able to get more details. Soumyo, Anant and DK Joshi, thank you very much for joining us. And now the correct headline is flashing. Maharashtra government has allowed Mumbai local trains for all from February 1st. Over to you, Nisha.
Thanks, Lata, for that. And of course, it's the lifeline of the city of Mumbai. And that has started. That's a big, big news development. But also, while we were discussing the source-based projections from the economic survey, there was IOC numbers flashing on our screens. In fact, take a look at that particular counter. There is an operational beat, and probably that's what Street likes. And that's really impacting the stock movement as well. So keep an eye out on that particular counter. Overall markets, Nifty has been at the low point of the trading session. And there is a little bit of volatility in a very tight range when it comes to the overall markets. Banks continue to be resilient in terms of Bank Nifty being over 0.5% up, and the mid caps are closing in on 0.5% gain, while Sensex and Nifty continue to be deeper in the red. So that's really coming in from the markets. It's time for a short breather.
Nisha, actually, just some more details on IOC. Sonal has just sent in. She's calculated the reported GRMs, which has come in at $2.2 a barrel. And the core GRMs is calculated at $1.27 a barrel. So this is an important metric. In terms of the other result, there was Manappuram that came out, and that too looked okay for now. The profit number was above what we had estimated. We had an estimate from Philip Capp, and the revenue too was up about 15-odd%. So those were the two numbers that came in. We'll get to all of this news in greater detail in just a bit. A quick break for now.